Accused today marks the sixth day of the partial government shutdown, and the prospects for a deal, they are bleak. Fresh off his whirlwind trip to Iraq yesterday, the president renewed his shutdown demands on Twitter. Quote, have the Democrats finally realized that we desperately need border security and a wall on the southern border? Trump went on to add, quote, do the Democrats realize that most of the people not getting paid are Democrats? This coming 2 days after Trump said that federal workers support his stand on the shutdown.
But many of those workers have said to me and communicated, stay out until you get the funding for the wall. These federal workers want the wall. The only one that doesn't want the wall are the Democrats.
It was Twitter where the battle over the wall largely played out today, though. Virginia Democratic Senator Mark Warner responding to the president, quote, this is outrageous. Federal employees don't go to work wearing red or blue jerseys. They're public servants, and the president is treating them like poker chips at one of his failed casinos. Minnesota's Amy Klobuchar, another Democrat, adding these shutdown workers work for the FBI and TSA, not GOP or DNC. They signed up to protect us and work for America regardless of party. Later in the day, the president firing off a pair of tweets accusing Democrats of obstruction on what he calls the needed wall, underscoring just how far apart both parties remain on this standoff. Illinois' Dick Durbin, the number two Democrat in the Senate, he wrote, no end in sight to the president's government shutdown. Now, technically, both houses of Congress were in session today. Although both the House and the Senate convened for only a few minutes, both took no steps to end the partial shutdown. House members were advised there would be no more votes this week, while the Senate adjourned until Monday at 4 p.m., effectively ensuring that the shutdown continues through the weekend and at least to the brink of the new year. I'm joined now by Yamiche Alcindor, White House correspondent for the PBS NewsHour, Eugene Robinson, columnist for The Washington Post, and Gwenda Blair, author of The Trumps, Three Generations of Builders and a President. Thanks to all of you for being with us. Yamiche, let me just start with you, trying to get to sort of the bottom line, the key players in this. You've got the president, you got the Republicans on Capitol Hill, you got the Democrats on Capitol Hill. Who has the appetite to extend this the longest and who the shortest right now, would you say?
I just got off the phone with a Democratic aide who says that Democrats are not going to budge on what the Senate already passed, which is this idea that essentially there will be no border funding in this CR. So Democrats are digging in and saying they're not going to do this. President Trump, through his incoming chief of staff, Mick Mulvaney, has already signaled that the White House is willing to come down on that initial $5 billion ask. But the president himself has not fully endorsed that. So the key thing here, of course, is that the House is going to turn into a democratically controlled House, and Nancy Pelosi is going to likely become Speaker, and that's going to make it even harder for President Trump to get what he wants.
Yeah, Eugene Robinson, there is a school of thought there that from the Democratic standpoint, that transfer of power on January 3rd gives them a new negotiating, new bargaining position, so perhaps there's a political incentive for them to wait until January 3rd to really make their move. There's also a school of thought that there are Republicans in Congress who might also prefer, if that's the case, because that potentially gives them somebody they can say, hey, the Democrats, you know, they've got some extra leverage here. Maybe it gives them room to carve out a deal they couldn't right now.
Well, I think that's kind of right, Stephen, in that right now, Democrats have no power. Republicans are in charge of everything. They managed to shut down the government all by themselves, controlling the presidency and both houses of Congress, and this is where we are. Come January 3rd, Democrats will have some power. They will have the House, and so I expect that they'll pass a funding bill without wall funding, and the president will say that's unacceptable. And who knows where we go from there. There isn't a lot of incentive for Democrats to start putting offers on the table, particularly since, as we've seen, you can get a deal signed, sealed, and delivered, except when it when it comes to it, Donald Trump won't sign it. And so why should they put something out and then have the rug pulled out from under them? And that's going to be the question for Democrats. Plus, the wall is really a stupid idea. And you just have to, let's deal with reality for a second. It's really a dumb idea. And that ought to count, too.
Well, Gwenda Blair, you know how the president thinks and approaches situations like this, negotiations, stalemates, public posturing, all the elements we're seeing right here. So if you've got Democrats who want to pass something when they get control of the House, it's going to have no wall money. You've seen before this shutdown, and certainly on the Senate side, it seemed a willingness on the part of Republicans to try to come to some sort of accommodation, some kind of deal here. The wild card, as Gene was just saying, becomes the president. If there's a willingness on the part of Republicans to compromise with Democrats on something, what about the president? Do you see somebody here who's executing some kind of long game strategy, who has an end game in mind? Is this somebody who's just winging it, who's just improvising it? How is he approaching this?
The long game for him is the same as the short game, really. Disruption, distraction, always pulling the rug out. Somebody, he was just referring to pulling the rug out. That's his play, is pulling the rug out so that nobody knows what to expect. And he is at the center always, and everybody's on the edge of their seat waiting to see what's going to happen.
Does he know, though, what I mean, obviously he'll say it's the wall, it's the wall. Does he have a very specific bottom line on this? Is there something, do you sense that it's something he's thought out? Look, I can settle for this. I can sell it as a wall. I can sell it as close enough. Do you think he's that specific in his sort of approach here?
He has to come out seeming like the winner, and he has to have his supporters, his constituency, come out seeming like they've won. And so does it have to be the wall? I don't think so. I think it has to be that he won, that he came out on top, he's vindicated, and that it's all about anger, keeping that anger stoked. It's the Democrats' fault, it's somebody's fault. He has to keep the anger thing going, and he has to come out on top and seem like the winner. If there can be a way that he can be the winner, and the word W-A-L-L somehow isn't quite there, or it's a picket fence, or it's a bunch of slats, or it's some bricks, or it's maybe it's just like, some kind of imaginary wall, whatever. It's okay, as long as he's a winner.
Hey there, I'm Chris Hayes from MSNBC. Thanks for watching MSNBC on YouTube. If you want to keep up to date with the videos we're putting out, you can click subscribe just below me, or click over on this list to see lots of other great videos.